Ooh. Fancy picture.
Nope. Did you get the picture?
We had a lot of Russian followers.
I just got to flip my... I'm mirrored.
Okay, hold on. I'm going to send you a new one. I need to make that text bigger.
Those Russian websites are not followers.
What? Yeah. Hey, you know, we've got reach.
We don't care about borders.
Yeah, to a Russian porn bot. That's all that is.
It's all about space borders.
I made Cheryl an admin, and hopefully she'll jump on that.
We're big in Russia.
Ben Hammer.
Let's go to speaker view.
Speaker.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another exciting episode of We Shot First. The Swissy is a short form for Star Wars Saga Edition. The Swissy. A Swissy podcast on Defiance. We shot first. Check out the, as Joe said, just as I posted the new artwork, he's like, ooh, new art. Talking to someone. So he kind of blown the fact that he's here tonight, but that's okay. I'm in the background. Haas the Cyborg is currently on the ship, not a kilometer away. Keep that in mind. He is planet side. We just make Joe show up and say, okay, you know, make fishy bubbles in your tank. Just so... he might get around to extending his cameo again. When last we left, you guys had set a record, a surprise round and a full round and a TPK, but not of the players, TPK of the innocent crazed believers. I mean, poor people just mind their own business in their own little cell abode.
Their name really doesn't lead to the feeling of innocence. The crazed believers.
they've got name tags.
A spear hole in Poser's chest. Would like.
I mean, I'd probably do the same thing if I was rushed by a bunch of Mormons. Not gonna lie.
I was gonna say that name only indicates a level of lawful versus chaotic, not necessarily a good versus evil. Someone could be very crazy, but also very good. Someone could be very sane and evil.
I noticed Aiden changed his name in Discord. I thought we had like a new listener because it said Young Jedi bracket something something, and I was like about to reach out. It's like formally Poser. I'm like, oh, it's Willems. Because you came in and you're like, actually, this, and a ruling. I'm like, oh, we got a new, you know, a new challenger enters the ring of, you know, rules lawyering and on those little
rooms in our old Discord. No, old challenger, new pants.
new name tag. I'm pretty sure sooner or later we will reveal his true name. Right now, since he just, I don't know, were you like the artist formerly known as Poser and they were just calling you Young Jedi? Well, the NPCs call you Young Jedi. What, I don't know what these guys call you. They still call you Poser, don't they?
Yeah.
I don't know what I call you. I probably never called you Poser.
Well, I can't call him Slucker anymore.
Mr. Jedi.
Yeah, you just called him Jedi or something, didn't you?
It's Mr. Jedi to you.
You will still make good Jedi in time. He is not Jedi yet.
So, getting back to the action at hand, I believe you guys did curse encase the room, found some minor items. Oh, some cobbled together armor. Oh, no creds. Oh, couple of spears. Not made of Mandalorian steel.
Sorry. And not Beskar.
Not Beskar.
No Beskar spears.
You know, those melt down and make awesome tiny little baby... Never mind.
Spoiler. Baby chainmails.
Is there anything in that room that doesn't have a bullet hole put in?
Yeah, we'll gather it up, chuck it on the cart. Why not?
Okay.
Never know if I might make a follower out of a few of these guys. Might need to arm them.
Okay. I'm actually going to get you to come down 0.5 there, Matt. That's... Now that you're full on show, it's, yeah, I'm getting too much echo, so just come down a little bit there.
Actually, all I thought I'm having to throw things. I could just start throwing weapons.
Oh, yeah. Tossing the spear, as it were.
Oh, dude, yeah, I never even thought of that. Do you have, like, the telekinetic projectile ability where you can, like...
No, he just wants to actually throw.
Yeah, literally just...
Yeah. He's finally given up on like his axe and he needs a new weapon, you know, like
I'm gonna be taking the penalty. I might as well take it at range out of threat. So
that's true.
Sure.
Fair enough.
Go through a whole list of like, exotic weapons, just trying them out.
Until he finally gets around to one that, you know. Anyway. So, guys. Jay Tamlin is not here tonight playing Dr. Leth. I will be schlepping him. However, off game, I did a couple of rolls to see if someone's noticing something. And I do believe Dr. Leth wants you guys sort of front and center to return to the park. Something peculiar going on here. Anyway, he, you know how he's like at the back of the line there? He rounds a corner and disappears. So you guys head back to the park room?
Yes.
Okay.
We follow him.
And one by one, enter the park. And we'll put this back up here. I'm just going to, for our video.
And in order that makes sense. And for radio.
Yeah, yes, yes.
Young Jay. It's his hip hop street name.
I don't think you'd get halfway across the room because you guys take the proverbial two steps into the room. And there's no sign of Jay. Poser pulls out. Get in there, you coward.
Oh, well, I was pulling back so Rahal wasn't standing literally in water.
Oh, okay.
But,
you guys come in shoulder to shoulder and your little lineup and everything, left, right. And it's a little darker in here than it was last time. There's no sign of Leth. Now, I'm assuming the natural thing to do is, you know, you turn on your lights, you guys spread out a little bit, but stay like a square adjacent. Like, no one's going to like wander off by themselves behind the rock.
We just turn flashlights on and start shining around.
Right.
Doctor,
so
where are you?
As let's start with Merrick. As you pick a spot to search, you know, you're scanning in the north side, take a step forward, right? Looking all around, you don't see the doctor. You turn and you find yourself alone.
Oh no.
As does perception. Everyone. You guys turn on a light, turn on a light, perception of 12, and the room seems to change. Where there was once an exit and an opening, there seems to be solid walls, and you find yourselves each alone in this park. As you walk back into this impressive chamber, and near a small bridge that appears crossing the stream, to the left, as before, is the large pond. Beyond, some kind of artistic hill or elevation made of simple mud rock, as before. Disharmoniously dead vegetation and dead bodies surround it all. Things you didn't notice before. They are sort of absorbed by the vegetation, hard-baked, turned brown. Something we didn't notice last time. As you take in your surroundings, your companions suddenly disappear from view and you are alone. Solid walls seem to have materialized out of nowhere and separate all of you. At the same time, blocking the entrance from which you came. You feel a deep sense of dread when a cruel figure from your past appears right in front of you. Someone you never imagined you would see again. You look around for a way out, but your feet don't respond. You try to cry out, to warn your companions, to get some kind of calm feedback, but the attempts yield no sound. You open your mouth and close it again and again, and nothing. As if in slow motion, the heartless figure prepares to attack. Rahal.
Yes.
A man dressed in robes from Coruscant, dictating him as part not of just of the Senate, but of the bureaucracy supreme court. And he has with him not one, but a lawyer with data pad and subpoena in hand for every ex-wife. And like some bureaucratic Sith Lord, his eyes menacingly glow and he raises a hand and motions for several lawyers to flank left and several right. They do not approach you, but they seem to cut off all hope. And the bureaucrat steps forward and begins a mind-numbingly long address of who he is, why we are here to speak with you, the atrocities and the things that will befall you in court, legally, existentially, and financially, and on it goes. Pause, Matt, for a moment. Merrick.
Yes.
What scares Merrick? I gave this a lot of thought. I got nothing. So calling upon the actual player, what from your past would be a literal skeleton in your closet? A father figure, a nasty drill sergeant from your sort of previous Halo home world?
It would be his younger brother.
Really? And does this younger brother have a name?
Ridley.
Okay. As you try to cry out, the helmeted figure wearing your old world militia army armor slowly advances. You see an officer's insignia outranking your old post on his arm. And a hand comes up and taps an automatic visor lifter. And as the glass snaps open, you see the face of your younger brother, Ridley, now standing before you, a decorated officer, looking at you in disgust and shame. Pause, Ryan. Young Jedi, it was you that was on the bridge, mucking around with a certain hard drive. It was you that watched the cursor come up and some cryptic messages about uploading and downloading. It was you back in the very first book that received messages from the Ostidius approaching. You have your master, Draco, Dina, and whatever the Aiden project might be, all in the back of your mind through this entire adventure. And every new person that comes into your life, besides your friends, every teacher or someone of influence that either wants something from you or needs you to learn something, they start stacking up. And the guilt that you felt from your master's death that Dina has been helping you through and to deal with, and the worry, not guilt, the worry that you may have done something to a ship which Rahal claims that he paid full price for and does not deserve any sort of caveat.
Paid more than full price for, thank you very much, sir.
Has a physical form. We found a humanoid cyborg in a panel in some sort of sleep cryogenic state. He was a pilot. He ran with us at the huts. And he started to act strangely, almost go mad. And Dr. Leth said he had some kind of episode and stuffed him back in that back tank. And now, a very upset-looking cyborg, the little cybernetic eye turned, you know, blood red, no reason, scanning the room. You know, that one laser beam is the first thing you see. And then you see Haas, the pilot cyborg, who is supposed to be on your ship a kilometer away, approach you with a menacing glare and a very, very large blaster pistol at his hip, and his hand goes towards it in a caddish banish style. Pause, Aiden.
Yes.
Doug Baldwin. Super fan, long time Saga player, our very first patron, and now book four's smash hit cameo, possible permanent addition to the podcast, playing Switch's field prototype gift, Dr. Leth, a droid to, shall we say, a certain DM maybe trying to make up for a certain caveat, allowed the players to extensively buff with wealth and things that in any other Reddit forum or other podcast that I've listened to would be considered overpowered at least. You are alone. No master. No charging unit. Sealed in a room and unable to access anyone on a comm internally, unable to access your vocabulator, and for some reason your servos and your locomotion become very sluggish, and you realize you cannot access a time frame of the last time you charged. 100 hours is the standard, and you can go far more if you have a battery pack that's, you know, accelerates that. And we do actually have a full on droid station portable on the ship, do we not?
We do.
I believe not a figure, but the fear of being left alone and have your battery slowly die out on a planet that you know has no way of juicing you, that if they leave you here, you would become trapped in a temple that will eventually fall and be buried and forgotten before you actually become a renowned prototype and first of a many built and revered droid on the line.
Buried alive. Buried alive.
Although, would it count as alive? Because you're a droid.
He's quoting. Lord, he's quoting Khan. No, that wasn't
that's
bad.
Lifeist.
It wasn't bad. It wasn't bad.
Stop being lifeist.
Your servos are sluggish. Your sensors—they don't go dim, but they become intermittent. Cut the signal, cutting in and out of your visual sensors. And a figure does appear before you. Not switch. Not Leth, and you can barely access a memory of your initial initial creation of a test, the first time your holistic processor was fired up and data was inputted. There was something there. There was a way of some sort of external visual or audio input accessing your brain, and you could hear but not necessarily understand without a voice translator or having that kind of software, that there was something with a will and a conscience that was bringing you forth from nothingness. And you feel that that consciousness, that thing, that person, alien, whatever it was that first invented you, built you, modified you, is in front of you, watching you slowly deactivate and doing nothing to stop it. Pause. Doug. So, Dr. Leth, not here, but I think he can have his own little horror show. His own teacher, the man who introduced him to science, the man who introduced him to Arcadian culture, the man who raised him, and the man who is terribly, terribly disappointed that he left and went off-world to research some, shall we say, not standard or much respected field of science. Dr. Leth's paternal father stands before him, and the look on his face demands answers. Where have you been? Why have you been off world so late? Do you have any idea how long your mother and I have been waiting up? Like, how long has this campaign been going on? That kind of thing. Dr. Leth, a brilliant man, always able to defend himself through literature, through words, through whatever, I don't care. Can't speak, can't bring forth any defense. His father's gaze boring into him, the lecture begins and continues and drones on, and Dr. Leth is powerless to defend himself. Besides actions from the waist up. It's maddening, gentlemen. What I have just described to you not only happens in slow motion, but seems to drag on. An endless silent communication between Merrick and his younger brother, an endless bureaucratic tirade of legalities that Rahal has to endure like some kind of some crazed Duros water torture. The power reading of how many hours in time fragments that TLXS has left won't register. It keeps glitching out. He loses sense of time. And for computer droid, that's probably very frightening. Dr. Leth, you can just imagine.
You skip Poser.
I know. We're getting to Poser.
We don't talk about Poser.
That's right. We don't talk about Bruno, and we don't talk about Poser.
First rule of Poser.
You find yourself back in the chambers. You had gone home to your world to check on things, maybe family that you never knew. Well, you were probably abducted at 5 like every other, you know, Jedi that comes for kids in a white van. Your people. The new Empire is oppressive. You go check on the Syrian people. Dina instructed you to seek out a master there. It's time, young one, to build your own lightsaber. No, the pieces you have are no good. Yes, I purified your master's crystal. No, you do need to actually go on a quest. Yes, you cannot go around that quest. Go home, get your shit together, change your wardrobe, come back to me later, and we'll talk. So off he went. Now, what degree of success did he have? I mean, he came back with a new wardrobe. He hasn't been flashing a lightsaber around. And he just been acting like everything's fine. I take you now to a scene that will probably actually replay later if we ever get around to the whole how I built my lightsaber Jedi crystal quest. But to give you a tiny little snippet, Poser may have found a crystal indigenous to his planet, but to find it, he may have had to traverse certain caves where a more common crystal is found, a Rubet crystal, the classic blue one. And in these caves dwell a beast called a Rubet Spinner. Poser. Yeah, Aiden's really upset with me right now. Poser, not a figure, but a creature emerges from the darkness. Many legs, many eyes, and more jacked up and messed up like those giant white creatures in the Snowy episode with the eggs that the Mandalorian ran from, if you're catching my drift. Spindly legs, multi-sectioned body, this thing stands before you, and in its spinners it actually holds a partially formed crystal. Now, I could think nothing better for role-playing purposes and trusting in the, although somewhat still new and budding, four-year friendship that I have with Aiden Willems, that he might forgive me that I place a real-world arachnid fear in front of the player so that we get some awesome role-playing out of Poser Sham, who is shamming his pants right now as he faces a space arachnid, a Rubet Spinner! Sunday, Sunday, Sunday! No, I'm not that mean. It's just some dude. He's just mean. He's really, you know, he's upset with you. And we'll see y'all next time. What? Oh, okay. Sorry. Guys, what do you do? These figures in front of you are obviously hostile in one way or form or another, whether passively or aggressively or physically, but the threat is imminent. They do look like they are about to attack you. I'm going to ask you to roll for initiative, but that does not mean you have to be hostile yourself. Pulling up the combat tracker. Don't forget to tag your mini boys.
So do I have Hoss or a giant Rubat spinner in front of me?
You have a giant Rubat spinner in front of you.
Ah, okay, gotcha. Oh, ha ha ha.
I'm going to put you guys...
Oh, wait. Ah, yes. I can reroll that.
What?
I can reroll my initiative check.
Why'd you get something out of 30?
I got a 4 on the dice for a 19.
Ugh, I got a 4 on the dice for an 8.
All right.
So fast.
That's so gross.
Can you roll for Kimmy? Matt?
Yep.
Okay.
Much better.
Much better?
She did well.
Yes, I got a 27.
Oh, okay.
Kimmy got a 23.
Joe Gibson, welcome back to the show.
Hey.
Hi. I don't have Haas on the board here, so I'm going to bring him up. Where are we here? Please tell me we didn't get rid of him. Well, there he is. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Haas. Would you ping your mini for initiative, please?
I would, but I can't get in, so.
So no. You can't get into the game?
Nope. Different system. I don't remember. Roll 20.
Oh, yeah. It's roll 20.
So
.net.
The last time I played Roll 20 was on a different system. Do I remember passwords and crap? No.
Possibly.
So, I'll try. That's what I've been doing. So just give me a little time.
Hoss hesitates.
Yeah. Look, Hoss, we can talk this through, all right? Just blue screen on the one side of the face.
Blue screen of death.
The blue screen of death. So I miraculously whip off the fastest email with an invite. Jesus Christ.
I can control his sheet and his token for now.
Yeah, that works.
Yep.
So starting with TLXS. Okay, I am going to take you guys to a different board so that you can sort of stay in, you know, like in the Imagitarium of the moment. Does that make sense? Just take you to like a galactic map. Picture the room that basically does still give you, you know, a circular breadth of like 4 squares down, 4 squares up, 4 squares, 5 squares ahead of you, and 2 squares back. You know what I mean? Like you're in like a 12 by 12 square room. Okay? And you're like a third of the way into the middle, and, you know, exact opposite distance coming out of the darkness comes this figure, this thing, this creature, this maker, this feeling, this whatever. So, starting with TLXS. Are you ready to meet your maker? Ha ha ha.
Please help me.
This thing in front of you does not seem intent on helping you. It becomes obvious with its fear gripping you. He attaches something to you and you get a boost. You think clearly. For a moment, you can see, you can hear, you can access memories, all is good. Then you realize he's attaching a device to power something else, like a mind wipe or a diagnostic or something that's about to become very invasive. But your systems are aligned. Your motive, you don't seem to be able to like run, but you can move and you do have access to your systems, talents, weapons, whichever. What would you do?
Well, after him not helping and I reach out and ask him to help me and he's being aggressive, then I would fire my heavy blaster pistol at him.
Okay. So you'll whip it out and shoot away.
Yeah.
Okay.
Pardon me.
Oh, I do have a quick question. You guys are at like mediocre health numbers here. Like, is like, am I looking at Merrick 73 of 95? I'm looking at Young Jedi's 48 of 78. Like, you guys aren't at full. You guys health. Went from.
We're a little bit hurt. I'm in good shape though. The doc patched me up.
Yeah, I am pretty banged up. I'm above 50%, but
what is your hit points, Matt?
I'm 69 out of 70.
69 out of 70?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, you're all right.
Yeah, I'm good.
Poser, you didn't get healed up in the little reprieve that
he
we made.
Did, but then he got his butt kicked in.
Oh, right, because you jumped into the fight. So you were currently at 48 of 78.
Yes.
Okay. All right. This may become confusing because I have to obviously do a lot of tracking here, but you shoot. Let's have an actual legit roll. Doug.
25.
25. I do believe that should hit. And your damage?
Would be 22.
Okay. Now, this information is easily accessible coming back. So I'm going to have you guys all act, and then I'm going to have them react, because that's the way they want this to play out. So, Haas.
Yes.
Who did I have you facing off with?
Young Jedi.
Young Jedi, yes. Thank you. What'd you do? You're angry. You want revenge. You scan a hostile threat. Does not come up in data and your data. Your cyborg brain is sort of was overriding your rational thought at this moment. You see a hostile. And you do have the, you know, character equipment, as it were.
Okay.
Let Aiden help you on your character sheet beat himself up. This ought to be funny.
Yep. This is going to be good.
The only two attacks I see are Sorrow Sub Firelands. So.
Oh, okay. Don't worry. It's just it's just a little pistol. Well, kind of.
All right. It's a rifle, but. So while Aiden pays close attention to what you actually do and does the actual roles in your place, have at it.
Sure. Shoot. Pew pew.
11, a clean miss, almost a warning shot. He saw you go for the Western draw. You shouldn't, like, this is why you don't wear a trench coat in Star Wars, because you got to pull it back over the gun. Everybody goes, oh, he's about to shoot me. I guess that's a waste of a swift action on his. I better get ready. And they always miss the first shot, unless you're Cad Bane. And everybody just squints at you, going, what's he doing? I don't understand. He's going for his gun, man. Like, what do you think he's going to do? That's not a threat. That's a, you know, last chance, right? Next we have the young Jedi himself. Haas shoots at you. Okay? But you know where Haas is. You know he's on the ship. You know he can't be here. And why this dark cave reminds you so much of those creatures that you had to face to get your crystal, why it's bubbling up now in sort of an anxiety.
Huh.
Maybe this cave is too much like theirs. I'm not saying you suddenly see Haas turn into a great big Rubik's Sprinter, but as he advances, as he shoots at you, that familiarity of, like, this place and...
Right.
You know, that kind of thing is... Your brain keeps going to the combat you already had on your home world, and you're finding trouble focusing against, oh my god, he just shot at you and you barely dodged.
Yeah.
Well, he rolled a one, he shot terribly, but you get the idea.
It's still blaster fire.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think blaster fire.
What do you want to do?
I was friend. Oh, Haas, hey, easy, chill. Remember, poser, we're a friend. Hey, chill. It's okay. And so as a standard action, I am going to use Adept Negotiator to try and lower him down the condition track. So I get to make a use the force check versus his will defense.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yep. Use the force check of 25.
You reach out with the force and you connect with the creature in front of you. Can I have a perception check for free?
Yes.
Part of the... Now, normally these cost actions, but this is like the way this encounter is written.
Right. 9.
Okay. You feel the familiar life force of the half cyborg, half pilot from the unknown regions that is Haas, and you have Adam, and you knock him... How many down?
It'll be 2 at this point.
Okay, so since you have access to the sheet, I will trust you to look after that. Okay?
Yes.
Haas is a soldier scoundrel with 52 hit points going into this encounter. Who knows what's going to be left when he comes out.
And then as a swift action, I am going to at least try and call out to the rest of the team, you know, over comms or whatnot. Just be like, guys, yeah, I don't know what's going on, but we're going to be okay. All right. Just trust me. It's going to be fine. And I'm going to activate, my light side power inspire. So I get to add to everyone's will defense. So with a use the force check of 27, everyone gets a +5 bonus to their will defense.
So it can affect them. You forget that you can't speak.
Right.
So reaching out with the force, making all kinds of puppy eyes. Hey, buddy, you, me, like this type of thing. I was going to roll with it for a negotiator. You know what I mean? Like, why not? It's me. Right. Look, it's Poser. You know, he shows you the arm. Austin Poser forever, a little tattoo. Don't tell anybody. You know, shit like that. Right? Come on, man. It's me. Like a lot of empathic eyebrows. So it's like, oh, I'll let you have it, right? But going, hey, guys. Hey, everybody. No, sorry. I'm not going to let you have that one.
No, and I forgot that we couldn't speak. So that is fair. Well, then, that's my turn. Try and reason with him.
Okay, incoming email, Joe. He starts pantomiming. You, me, friends, hug. Kimmy. Matt.
Yes, Kimmy.
Yes, Matt. Samantha is unavailable this time, so your cohort.
Yes.
You are not Kimmy, so I won't get into at the moment what terrible fear or person that she faces. But I do know that she gets out that hairdryer and starts charging it up. And
is aggressive.
Yeah, she is alone and she needs to defend herself. And little Kimmy is getting approached and attacked by the big bad. Out comes the hairdryer. What does this thing do?
It's nasty.
Go for it. Go for it.
Squibbed head. Roll to attack?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's have it.
She rolled poorly with an 11. Damages.
The squib tensor rifle.
Very nice. So, yes. It's a squib tensor rifle, and basically a successful attack always lowers somebody one step down the condition track. It shoots little mini black holes, and it makes a horrible, horrible loud banging noise when it fires. It's nasty. It's nasty. It's a gun that shoots black holes, man. Like, little itty-bitty singularity.
Okay. Well, like I said, she charges it, and the little black hole swirl starts on the end of the hairdryer, and then somebody, steps aside kind of thing. So, maybe it's the, you know, the dice rolls are explained with that sort of big black hole lead in, somebody going, maybe I should not be in front of this thing. Yeah. And it was the Spider-Man thing and jump, right? Whenever somebody attacks, somebody's just like, and jump. All right. And we have Rahal, I believe. Have I missed anyone?
And I can't speak.
No.
I think you missed Merrick. I don't see him. Oh, he didn't select his character token when he rolled for initiative, probably.
Classic Messina.
I'm on the galaxy. Are we all on the galaxy map right now, or is it just me?
Yeah, you're on the galaxy map because I want you guys to, like, up in your heads, just you, this dark cave, gotcha. Yeah. And you know what I mean?
Yeah, no mini to select.
Right.
No. You didn't even roll initiative, actually. I don't see it anyways.
I don't want to fight my brother. No. He wins.
Well, actually, I rolled a 12 for perception. Oh, yeah, I'm thinking, sorry, wrong system.
That's okay. Can I have an initiative from you? And speaking of perception, I already had, was it Poser?
That's a 30 initiative.
All right. 130 going in for Merrick. So you already had initiative, a perception looking around with your 12. I'll hold that. I would like perception from the rest of you. And let's go back to, well, between TLXS and Haas, we'll just throw you in there. While they're rolling their perceptions, Merrick, what would you do?
That's you?
You think this. So I don't mind you guys like role-playing character, but keep in mind that the actual words don't come.
Dude, like, he is like, thinking and saying whether he hears it or not. It's right. One of those things.
Oh, yeah.
Like, because one thing that was known is his brother's dead.
Yep.
So.
You left me, big brother.
You disobeyed orders.
You left us all on our homeworld to die. And
you
now,
disobeyed. You left the squad. And Merrick charges him.
Okay. That won't matter anymore. And he pulls his gun and you charge.
Yeah.
You gotta tackle him in your big shiny armor.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
Okay, yeah.
Merrick's looking to punch him in the, put his fist through his stomach.
Oh, okay. I thought you were going to put him in the pool, you know, solve the problem, blah, blah, blah.
No, no, no. remember back to the last, remember the
dark.
Sorry.
If you want to reach back to the times that there was a surprise rocket punch.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're doing that again.
Cool.
It's so a surprise rocket punch.
So you
it's
actually.
A full burn.
Take one out of your 10 of your jetpack, please, and he just that's
and
cool. You have that mech stomp stomp and then you know the full on.
Why did you not listen?
Opening your mouth, no sound comes out, but the thoughts rampaging in your mind. Can I have your attack for this?
He's going for a melee, so...
Yep.
It's not like
a... There should be a melee on your sheet near the top right. There should be some kind of base attack with strength you can just add, that kind of thing.
I made one, just called it Fist, and just modified it off of strength.
No, if you've got it.
It's 1d6. I don't know if anyone knows what the untrained melee is. Maybe 1d4?
I'll give you a D6 in your suit because you've got the gauntlet, that's fine.
All right. Submit.
Unarmed strike is D6 plus
strength.
Your level in strength, half your level in strength.
Yeah. So 19 to hit.
Okay.
It's raw rolled and 8 damage on the knuckle sandwich.
On the knuckle sandwich. Okay. You rush him. And he just turns sideways and gives you the sort of head shake like, that's not going to work. And it's a clean miss as you come powering through. Ah! And next we have catching up with, let's talk about those perceptions that I missed. Rahal.
Rahal got a 19 and Kimmy got a 20.
Okay. TLXS.
Got a 9.
And Merrick had 12. And we did Poser. And Haas. Let's have one for Haas. Courtesy of Mr. Willems. Cool. 17. So, round 2? No. A response from each person. Right? Let's start with Kimmy.
Supper Hall.
Sorry?
But I can't talk, so I can't really respond.
I meant like the guys in front of you are, you know, attacking, that kind of thing. Kimmy. Her fear. You know, pulls a weapon, lashes out in kind with a range energy weapon and a clean miss. Next, we have missing. Did you roll to actually attack? No, you were what was it? Trying to knock Haas down the condition track.
Yes.
And you've tracked that, sorry. I feel like I'm missing something. No, I think everyone's gone. Rahal, what were you doing with your lawyer?
I'll
That's right, because we didn't
spend an action to do some knowledge stuff for bureaucracy to see if I can legalese my way out of it.
Sure. No, I did not sign anything. I swear.
Knowledge bureaucracy of 31.
Okay. First of all, your knowledge bureaucracy tells you that what they're spewing at you is actually airtight. It's surprising what they've dug up, but your knowledge of 31, you think it'd be like, aha, I've got this. You know what I mean? It actually solidifies their argument. And that in itself doesn't make sense, because it's like, if they have found a loophole and you see it, you should know the workaround. And your perception, what'd you get?
19.
Kind of, as this is happening, your perception of 19 registers. It's like, this is like kangaroo court stuff. This is trumped up charges. The dates don't line up. I was never there on that date. I was with the other ex-wife. Wait a minute. Like, there it is. Their case is airtight, but all the dates and names are screwed up, which means they've got nothing. And you realize this shit isn't real.
Okay.
So at the beginning of beginning of your turn, and you're working, your brain's like, think, you know, go, Johnny Neutron, right? It all, three things become clear. They've got nothing, the technicality, you win, and it's not a lawyer in front of you. He, you know, you find it, you try to state it, but again, no voice comes out. But it's almost as if the bureaucrat realizes that you see, you know, that you've worked out the math. And in frustration, he throws down the pad and just rushes at you like a maniac. Like the dude's going to try and punch you in the face. You easily step aside. He goes stumbling past you, and it's not a bureaucrat. The subpoena lawyers disappear, and Merrick goes flying past you on his jetpack, and you see Merrick, your own bodyguard, has turned on you. Round two.
Run away!
This shit's scarier than the lawyers, right? I pay this guy. TLXS.
Was there any impact from my shot last round?
What did you get?
I had rolled a 25 with 22 points of damage. I probably have hurt somebody else in the party, but my character doesn't know that.
Yeah, I should have just said he came out of it instead of going, it's Merrick, big reveal. I'd like this go on, my bad.
No, it's fair.
We'll edit.
I just want to know whether my character has seen any change since I fired what seemed to be a hit at.
So not yet, but what do you wish to do? Because we're talking about intent at the moment.
Well, 6 seconds have passed since I thought I shot something, and I
right.
Don't
and you
know
you did you did shoot him, but you didn't kill him. He takes a shot.
Did,
he seems to
did
get.
Did he
angry.
Look like he took a hit?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
You look like you're making progress, but he just looks angry.
Then I'm
he doesn't
absolutely
go down.
Firing again.
Okay.
Absolutely.
All right. Can I have a perception check, please?
Sure.
In that opening moment, that opening seconds of, you know, check my work, right? the bleeding out of 5.5 to 6 at the end of round 1, I shot him. What's the result? Does he react in pain? He does. He gives you that, you shot me, kind of face.
Oh, good.
You know. Can I have a perception check?
Perception
please?
Check is 24.
24. His face contorts in pain. It is a solid hit. And then his face contorts and morphs. And it's not your creator. It's Dr. Leth, your master, who you've just shot for 20. For how many? 19 points of damage. Your pluralistic processor, your processor goes nuts as you. It's not like you can't shoot, master. It's that you have, and now your processor's going goes nuts through the data, trying to process. Yeah, trying to process that you did something that you're programmed, you know, not to do.
I dropped my weapon and
a new string of code has entered the battle.
Yes. Now here's a good opportunity to pause something. Okay. Third degree droids, like protocol droids, can't hurt sentience. Fourth degree, which you are, can. Right. But there's no restraining bolt on you. You've just been programmed to serve master. So as far as I know, now they talk about getting into the independent droid, and it's only when you look at that prestige class that people that play regular droids take them for granted, going, well, I do what I want, and he's my boss. I do what I want. No, it's not like that. You guys do not have any kind of freedom until you take that prestige class, making your own decisions, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, oh, shit, so rules verbatim. Now, you've role-played this character excellent. You have been the aggro on the field. You've protected everyone. And when you're not protecting Leth directly, you've protected VIPs in his place. So I have no problem with you not following your programming. But in this case, I'm curious, because I was just looking at this stuff in the rules and hearing about it, from our rules lawyers, Aiden and such, am I missing anything? Like, how would a droid react to realizing that it just violated its programming?
Imagine this will almost be like dividing by zero.
Yeah.
Almost. So not quite. Fraction of zero.
I'm going to have the dark side that's down here, the one I was teasing Aiden about, going, every time you try and do something, it attacks you. I'm going to have it attack your willpower, and if it succeeds, it's going to knock your ass down the condition track. However, you get caught in a loop. It doesn't do damage to the processor, but you find... was it like when you try and do something, you ever pull up Taskmaster on your computer and all of a sudden your card or the CPU starts burning up to like not 100%, but it's like, wow, something is chewing up and slowing down my shit.
Yeah.
That is what's happening to you now. You're just like, right? You hesitate. So you perceive, you hesitate all your actions, and your last one is your gun slowly dropping down to the stone, clink, as you realize that an infuriated and still not seeing you for what you are, Dr. Leth is holding his gun in hand. Merrick, a rush and a miss at Riley.
Merrick's fist just slams in the ground. Yep. We miss. He does a 180. Rocket shut off. Shortly distance from where he missed Riley, he stands up, full stature.
Also, it looks like
you back.
Looks like a breakdancing move.
That's yeah, awesome. Almost.
Yeah, that's awesome. Sorry.
I will bring you back home this time. I will not fail. Even if I have to break your arms and legs.
And he just menacing walks towards Riley with the intent of doing as he promised. Okay.
Your words that I cannot hear, don't forget that, mean nothing to me. As you well know, I am dead and you soon will join me. If that's okay with you. Merrick. Medic, as Rahal is frantically going, Merrick, hey, oh shit, I'm saying your name. It's worked into the dialogue. Medic, I said extra medic for no reason. And Merrick, you know, remember that time I hired you? What are you talking about? Merrick, can I have a perception check, please?
Certainly.
Your brother was a stickler for rank. When we were in the military together, he called you by your rank. He never called you by your name. And if he did call you by your name, he called you by your last name. Sergeant this, Corporal that. You know, do you have a last name? Or is that dead and buried on your home world?
That's why it was never used.
I figured. No paper trail.
Perception of 20.
It's not like your brother to call you by your name and be so dramatic. He was a man of action and few words, even fewer than you. So for him to like monologue like this doesn't seem like it. And then the Russian accent starts getting a little Jersey. And as he comes at you, weapon in hand, leveling it in your face, and you're rushing him again, he's not bringing a weapon in your face. Falling away is the armor and the military in your brother's face, and you see Rahal frantically trying to reason with you. No, he's running away. There he goes. Runs past you, sprints across the bridge. There he goes. But you see Rahal.
if you allow Merrick's hand to actually land on his shoulder.
No, do an attack. You know it's Rahal now. If you try to grab Rahal, that's player choice.
Can he speak now?
No.
That'd
be too easy.
Can I roll perception again?
Can I roll perception again?
Yes. No, no. I thought I rolled an attack. Sorry.
Yeah.
I thought wrong button. Apparently,
there's a grab button in the top right.
Oh, here it. Oh, okay. Oh.
There's an actual grab
attack
button.
Attack 10. Oh, there is a grab button.
Yeah. Give me the grab button. I'll let you have it.
Where is it?
Top right of the character sheet. Grapple, under your base attack.
You have to successfully.
Under your initiative. At the top there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, there's a grapple. There it is.
There's a grapple. There's a white pin sight stroop. Grab, grab, grab.
I rolled the exact same number. 14.
He got so excited because he thought it was getting him out of that roll. Okay. So the hand, you feel the fingers brush on your shoulder, Rahal, but yoink! He's away. Rahal's out of there.
Just Matrix out of the way.
Yep. Next we have Haas.
Yes. Haas.
Can I have a perception for Haas?
Sure.
I'm getting there.
Are you back? Are you back in?
Yeah, that took forever.
Turn off your chat beeps, buddy. Go into settings.
To me?
Yeah, you. Go into your settings on Roll 20 and shut down all that, because every time you do something, I get whoop. Weep. It's a new druid.
Go to the settings and then text chat options and then turn off enable background chat sounds.
We're learning Roll 20 on top of Star Wars Saga. I'm going to leave that shit in because I don't want to edit. I'm too quiet, tired this week. Okay. Where was I? Joseph G. Perception of 19. Joe. Yep. You are not here in a dark cave facing off with what you believe is a hostile. You are in a backed tank and you actually gain consciousness. You wake up in the tank. Finally. All nice and healed too.
Oh, yay.
You peer through the glass. You're alone in a barely lit laboratory.
Familiar space.
Yep.
Is it that familiar though?
This is your ship, man. I mean, somebody bought it, renamed it. Your crew is long gone, and you're trying to forget them. These guys that hired you on as a pilot, again, pay better or worse, up to you to decide. But, you know, you wake up, and your cyber brain is hooked into the system because something has accessed your brain. You realize that whatever had a hand puppet up you is left, but the sleeve is still there. You actually have access to ship systems, which means you can open the tank and drain it and get out.
Oh, cool.
So use computer, standard stuff as an action. You can get out of there.
That sounds good.
Yeah. Oh, happy day on one perception check.
Oh, happy days.
While he's doing that, let me know what you get. Young Jedi.
Yes.
You're facing off with an angry hoss.
Yes.
What do you want to do?
I'm going to continue to try and communicate via sign language, even though neither of us speak it. Mm. And try to continue to negotiate with him, like, friend, hands open, palms out, you know.
So young Jedi invents Pictionary on the spot, and he's like, okay. Starts doing pantomime and shit.
35. So that'll drop him two more down the condition track.
Okay. Bringing him to what?
Be a negative 10.
Okay, so one more and he's out cold.
One more. And then he treats me as friendly.
Okay.
Because that's a special caveat to Master
Now, the real Haas is awake. So bring Haas's sheet back up to normal. Okay. But we are tracking your opponent at negative 10.
Okay. Done.
Now, even with a negative 10 because of communication barrier giving you a 25, would it be two or just one?
It's always two if I beat the will defense.
Oh, okay, so it's not a plus five more, plus 10 even more kind of stuff.
Right. So okay. Normally it is just one per, but I took a talent that makes it two every time I beat the will defense.
Yeah. No, I'm just making sure it's based on the character's will, not like so many force powers are like beat this by 10, like beat the DC by this, and you get even more candy, you know, that kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Whereas this is a talent instead of a power.
Gotcha. All right. And that's your thing, and I need perception from you.
Alrighty. 18.
Okay, you realize suddenly that this menacing Haas isn't Haas. He shoots with the wrong hand. The gun is on the wrong hip. It's almost like a mirror image. The eye is the wrong cyber eye. It literally is like a mirror image. You were so intense on, oh my god, it's Haas and he's evil and he's terminated, he's going to kill me. And it's like, wait a minute. Huh. The cyber eye is on the wrong side. The cyber net, like, it completely, it's Nega Haas. Okay. Realizing this, and like I said, this force connection that you're projecting the force at your opponent, and the two of you are connected, it seems to sense that you're onto it.
Okay.
And it fades. Haas dissolves and becomes Kimmy, who's holding a hairdryer, and a little black hole is...
Oh, no. Oh, I've seen what that's done.
You imagine if you killed Matt, if you had killed Matt's new, Matt's new thing, little friend. He would totally blame me, but it's like, you killed Kimmy. That's something that would go a long way. The most innocent, tiny little person. So nice. Yeah, you know.
Well, not quite.
Well, that would end up being the joke for the rest of all the books is, Poser, you killed Kimmy. Come on.
Nice.
You bastard.
You killed Kimmy. Next, we actually have Kimmy.
Followers are replaceable.
Yes. Now, you had rolled perception for Kimmy before, and she had gotten 20.
Yeah, she got a 20, yeah.
And luckily, right, before she fires, right, she suddenly gets really close to you and sniffs the air. And by scent, oh, he smells like, what would a Syrian smell like with a big cone head? I'm thinking somewhere between, like, Old Spice and a banana. I don't know.
I figured Poser would probably more smell like metal.
Jedi name, the spicy like banana.
He smells like metal. He smells like he smells like lacquered wood guitar and leather boots.
Angst and teen regret.
Lacquered banana.
Oh, that's so good.
Yay. Teen spirit.
Oh, shit. You know,
in a can.
I said I was gonna. Did you hear what Matt said? Why am I the only one losing my shit?
Did you I heard it. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I also made a great song reference, but I.
That's why I'm about to give him a force point because that was freaking gold.
Boom.
He makes a joke while making a song reference. Now I told everyone I'd stop doing this because we have patron points built up. But come on, you got to give Matt that one. That was really good. And the fact that I'm still giving Matt points and Ryan the odd point, and everybody else, but. Aiden points is, you know, it's par for the course. So moving on.
It's important. It's very important. He can really use them. Like, we can kind of use them, but he can really use them.
Everyone gets
you get a force point, and you don't get a force point. But the person beside you gets three.
I see the robot chicken where Oprah starts with, what do you want? And the guy's like, I'd like a sandwich. Look out of your seat. He pulls out a sandwich. He's so happy. But then everybody around him starts getting houses, and he's like, oh. Shit. Dude pulls out this massive Dagwood sandwich. He's so happy. And everyone's like, yeah. And what about you? Oh, what a house, right? Then, yeah, you got a house. You got a car. You got a house. And he's like, you just see the guy like, oh, no. I should dream bigger. Rahul.
Yes.
You're closing on a wall.
Closing on a wall?
You're still sealed in a room.
Okay.
With a guy who thinks you're his little, what? Well, yeah, he probably said brother in there somewhere. He's doing some kind of breakdance fighting with you. The problem is you're wily. Like, he can't get a hold of you, but he's fast.
I thought I saw Merrick, and you now do. I'm running away from him.
You do. You are. But you're like, you run. You do. You
so
are.
I'm running towards a wall.
I'm just saying, like, this room is not, you know, not opened up yet. What do you do?
Get my back in a corner and do the whole whoa 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 whoa.
Okay.
You know, I can't go whoa 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 if I cannot speak.
Crying is a free action.
I wonder. Perhaps I could use the force to form a telepathic connection with him to convey.
Oh. Now,
can I do that? Yes, I can do that. That's just standard use the force, right?
No. Do you have to have two force sensitive guys to do it, or can you do it with a normie? So. You look into that. We'll get back to you. We'll call this round three, but I'm very intrigued to hear more about that. TLXS.
He just needs to have an intelligence of two or higher. You have an intelligence of two or higher, right?
I have a one and a two in my intelligence. Yes.
Nice.
Okay. All right. Give me a use the force check.
Who? Me?
Use the force.
No, him. Him.
And hold on. Is it a willing against an unwilling target? So I'm assuming it's unwilling.
That's fine. It's fine. I got an idea. We can roll with this.
All right.
If you can
use the schwatz.
If you can beat his will defense.
Of 19.
20. Oh! I rolled so bad, but because my charisma stat's so high, I'm a boss with using the force.
Okay.
Can't really do much with it, but this is something I can do.
He's projecting
my margins.
Your mind.
He's projecting doubt. Now, I'm not going to let him use the force 20 as a perception for you. because that's not what he said he was doing, but I will allow you to immediately make a perception check as he's trying to jar your mind with doubt and no, it's me.
All right, so make a perception.
Yep.
Perception of 23.
Yes, it's not your brother. It's Merrick.
Ridley!
Oh. He's like, he's got you against the wall. Like, there's the jet comes, you know, type of thing, and he suddenly pulls up short, does that hover skid, you know, right? He's got the arm vibrating. And, You gotta let the energy go, Merrick. It's you gotta put something.
Wall's right there above his head. Column just says goodbye.
Yeah. You punch the wall, he pees a little and mumbles something about a raise, and you guys are friends again. TLX.
No, I didn't. I did not.
Would you like to burn a force point so you don't shit your pants?
No, I probably don't even know if a force point would help with that. It's Merrick we're talking about.
Yeah, it's true.
It's huge. I am not. I just spent a lot of money making him way tougher than he needed to be.
And you see BD pop around the corner, like almost apologetically.
Now I know how Dr. Frankenstein felt.
Oh yeah, well BD's here totally succumbed. He's beating the shit out of like a space rat, you know. some poor little like tulip, you know, bud or something that's growing on the
just
ground,
just laying the kicks to it, like violently,
just beating the shit, just jumping up and down, just you know, like it's obviously down. And he's still going.
Yeah, vicious. we're PG-13. That's R rated over in the corner.
Yeah, so we don't talk about BD and Bruno. TLXS, you realize you shot your master. Your master is still going for it. Now, you are the beginning of the next round. I need to deal with everyone that has not come out of this, as in, like, you know, everybody else. So, did I miss Leth in the... Yeah, I did. So, Dr. Leth gets a perception. And now it's kind of cat out of the bag. I'll let you guys roll it. I've been using...
Who's wrong?
No, I've been, like, using the hard dice quietly over here. I'm not even dropping my tower. I'm, like, rolling on the soft table and just like, nope. Leth, no shit. He's just getting madder. Oh, let's get madder. Right. He keeps missing you, too.
25. Okay. Doctor.
So, pulling his gun, taking a couple shots as the rounds were going by. I forgot to talk about the results of Leth's anger. He suddenly, you drop your weapon. And he seems to notice it, like the bang on the floor, the noise of it dropping seems to snap him out of it. And he puts his gun slowly away and he says, TLXS, run diagnostic. Which is a nice way for Master to say, are you all right? You'll work him up to a hug in the future, but right now, run diagnostic for me is the nicest way he could probably, in a Leth way, say, are you okay? And Merrick's come out of it. Go ahead. Hang on. He comes over and he kind of tries to do like a reboot, like a hard, you know, reset. Okay. He shuts you off. He asks everybody to vote. Vote now. Do I turn him back on? Is he a pain in the ass? Is he worth all this trouble? I don't mean TLXS, I'm talking about Doug. Vote now. Not sorry. No, seriously. He shuts you right down and then turns you back on and allows you to do a restart, like a full reboot. And you should be okay. Young Jedi.
Yes.
I believe you'd come out of it. You're facing Kimmy, who came out of it. Is everybody come out of it? Yeah, and Dr. Leth, right? So, yeah. You guys realize that you were fighting each other for some reason. You stepped into a room, everything went dark, and I'll bring you back to the room now. you guys got very confused. You saw someone terrible from your past. They became very agitated and aggressive instantly. You were forced to honestly defend yourselves. And then as fate would have it, and your own perceptions and working your way through this nightmare, you realize you were fighting allies. And now that has stopped. What do you do? Hoss.
Yeah.
You're out of your cage. The laboratory sure. The laboratory is empty.
All right. Do a use a computer, I guess.
Sure.
Quick scan.
Okay.
Of the actual no, ship.
Okay. No life forms aboard. Okay. Now, even though you're detached for the tank, you seem to have remote control of not all the systems, but you seem to be able to access or like go over to his lab and just, you know, scump or access his computer, right? Now, he has a personal computer, and that's where all his files and stuff are. And he has like a computer that's the ship's computer with personal stuff on it that you cannot access. But it's still a ship computer that allows you to like, well, it's still a panel. I can still, you know, find out any life forms on the ship. No, besides you. Right.
Okay.
The ship is functional, has an adequate amount of fuel, and is abandoned. And the last astro jump brought you to Elmis, which you were not familiar with because you're from the unknown regions. They've just taken you deeper into, you know, the rim and like the places that you do not know.
Yeah. Interesting. Border ship all by myself in the middle of freaking nowhere.
Sitting happily on a planet. Now, there isn't technology on this planet. The planet seems pretty bare. There's a couple of scattered life forms a couple kilometers away, and there are ruins, like a structure that has collapsed. And you're in a city that is also abandoned, mostly. There are creatures, mostly, as opposed to trying to scan sentience. From what you can tell from the scans, this place looks like it's been, you know, blown up and abandoned.
Oh.
And there's huge, huge crop famine. Like, oh my God, look at that grass burnt 2 kilometers away from like some kind of, but it's radiating out like disease or plague or something. Perhaps there's a contaminant on this world.
Perhaps.
you scan some basic life signs and world systems, and you learn that the oxygen is 50% richer than normal. So actually natural healing would work better. But the atmosphere itself is certainly toxic, and without a rebreather, you guys would succumb to some nasty, you know, like a couple days. Because there's not just oxygen, but there's something in the air like a sulfur or a methane that, it's not like radiation, but it is something that'll mess you up if you breathe it for like a, you know, like a day or several hours.
All right.
Space asbestos.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. What do you want to do?
That is a very good question. Is the R4 or any of the, that's the only one I know. Is R4 on board?
Yep. No. TP is on the big ship. Where's R4? Is he here? Yeah.
R4
okay.
is on this ship, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I guess I'll go talk to R4.
Okay. He beeps and boops and says it. So he talks about your companions and a new droid have landed.
Okay.
He something about, like, it's a new mission. Like, he doesn't know all the details, but the same people from the resurgence that sent you to the huts sent you here. He doesn't know why. They're looking for something in the ruin, and he's guarding the ship.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Well, then I'll take the ship.
while you are talking to R2, you hear a voice in your head.
Oh.
The Bacta tank has fully healed your body. Perhaps not psychosis in your mind, but it's fully healed tissues. And memories start flooding back to you. Haas's memories. The real Haas organic Haas, not you. You are synthetic, software, sentient, a process that works cybernetically and has hijacked organic tissue to function, but the will and the actual memories of actual Haas start coming flooding back. Do you guys remember the first time I brought Joe into the show?
And do in the you remember?
And in the darkness, I had a terrified voice to which Joe Gibson soothingly, Joe Gibson's own voice, soothingly said, it's okay, it's all right. And this panicked voice was repressed and not destroyed, but definitely, you know, did not come out on top of the Battle of Wills. I put it to you now, the most perfect hiding place for Aiden is not in every piece of hardware and software that Leth ripped apart, is that because of the unknown regions and our knowledge of the Yuuzhan Vong in the future, somewhere in the unknown regions, there is actual biotech. And the Aiden Project hid in Haas's organic brain and controlled him. And Joe has been playing Project Aiden this entire time. Haas, voiced by me, got all Jarvis'd by Ultron, you know what I'm saying? Now, a lot of time has gone by, and our Ultron, our Project Aiden, has gone through some changes. And in this dodge, he has gained knowledge, and I wouldn't say humanity, from being in an organic brain, but you are certainly not the invasive, knowledge-consuming, self-aware construct that you once were. You have been a software program. You have been inside droids. You have been inside ship systems. You have been inside in the human mind. And now had convinced yourself that you were Haas. And now Haas wakes up. His consciousness is fighting to surface, and you come to the horrible realization that you are a holistic alien processor software, the equivalent of a alien unknown regions droid brain that has been adrift and put into hard drives, systems. You remember the wars in the unknown regions, how you were a virus designed to attack battle droids, take them over, and render them to the opposite side. Time and again you did this, and as you attacked more advanced systems, and as they, your creators, worked on the virus and decided they wanted to make it like a droid or make it like thinking software, you outgrew them, you escaped, you ended up in that drive. But that's another story, perhaps even another show. Now, Joe Gibson, who actually is the Aiden Project, not Haas, I'm Haas, the NPC, has to make a decision. What would you do? As in all these milliseconds of coming forth, you realize that you're not a man. You are a parasite, a synthetic one, far superior to any droid or holistic program or software. You are unique, alien in origin, and have been borrowing a cyborg to hide and get by. What would you do?
Either A, continue, or try to continue, or find a new host, if you want to call it that.
All right. While you contemplate this, I will leave you be and come back to the game at large next time on We Shot First, the Saga Edition. Wow, we're in book 4, Echoes of the Jedi. I want to say Echoes of Ultron.
Oh, I wanted to say shitting on the Jedi.
Say goodnight, Joe.
Good night, everyone.
Strong and I feel it still.